and well done for the organizers for putting together this wonderful conference. This is the last panel, and it is Saturday afternoon, after all. So we'll try to make this as interactive and as lively as possible, and this is why we have a debate. And the motion that we are debating is, and I quote here, increasing transparency in commercial investment arbitration, a welcome reform, question mark. And so we have two debaters that will be debating for the motion and two debaters that will be debating against the motion. I will be taking a poll in just a minute to see what your current gut feeling is, whether you're rather leaning for or against. And then we will hear the debaters, and then we will do the same at the end, and I'll ask you again to vote with your hands for and against, and we'll see whether the debaters have actually potentially swayed you either way. But before I take the poll, let me just very briefly tell you how we understand this motion. Transparency is a buzzword. You know, it's really, everyone talks about transparency at the moment. In the previous panels, actually, transparency came up quite often when we talked about the European Commission's proposal on an investment court, that this would lead to a more transparent system. There is, of course, the transparency rules, the institutional transparency rules, and the Mauritius Convention. So transparency is a buzzword, but what do we actually mean when we talk about transparency? Now, let's just remind us what transparency means. Transparency, in the sort of first common sense of the word, means easy to see through, you know, transparent. And that metaphorically also means that something becomes more visible and therefore potentially more easier to understand. And so in the context of international arbitration, transparency is very often used to allow more information to circulate, a flow of information. And that flow of information is between the players of international arbitration on the one hand and everyone else. Now, who do I mean by player of international arbitration? There are, of course, the parties, their legal representatives, the arbitrators, the institutions, the insiders, so to speak. And then there are the outsiders, if I may say it that way, which are the NGOs, non-disputing parties, the public as a whole. And the information that flows between the insiders and the outsiders increases transparency. And that flow of information can be two ways. It can either go outbound from the insiders to the outsiders, or inbound the other way around. Now, just a couple of examples of outbound transparency, information that flows from the players of international arbitration outside. First of all, of course, is on a specific dispute, is if it's clear that a dispute happens, that it's registered, that everyone knows X has a dispute against Y, and potentially even here are the facts. That is would be a transparent system. And we, of course, all think here about the institutional transparency rules that have inaugurated a register where information about cases under these transparency rules is publicly available. But also, and maybe this is something that we don't think about so much, transparency in the sense of dispute resolution system as a whole. Information about who sits as arbitrator, how many challenges are there. And there are, of course, a lot of initiatives by institutions. The ICC very prominently has now a register where you can see who is sitting as arbitrator under the ICC cases if parties agree to put that up. And this is outbound transparency. And then we can also think about inbound transparency, which is information flowing from the outside to the tribunal. And here, of course, a good example is amicus curiae, third-party submissions to the tribunal. And again, the information that flows to the tribunal is arguably to get a better understanding, be more transparent, and so that third parties, amicus curiae, can actually have a say in the dispute before the arbitral tribunal. So I just wanted to sort of give you a very sort of broad brush of potential examples on how we understand transparency, and that is in a very broad sense, both commercial arbitration and investment arbitration. And now think again about the motion here in front of you, which is is the increasing transparency in commercial and investment arbitration a welcome reform? So could I please ask those who think that it is yes, it is a welcome reform, to put up your hands? Okay, now let's do the counter test. Can I ask those who are against to put up your hands?
Professor, does it make a big difference whether it's commercial or...
Yes, absolutely right. So I'm going to ask the question, first of all, generally, and then break it down. But I think for the general question, there was a clear leaning towards four. So note that in terms of your starting block. Now, absolutely right. We're going to break it down into commercial and arbitration. Let's start with commercial first. Who thinks that increasing transparency is a good thing in commercial arbitration? That's already less. Now let's do the counter test. Against? I think that's slightly more, but just about slightly more. And now in investment arbitration, who thinks that increasing transparency is a good thing? I think that's a very clear majority. I don't even have to put in the counter balance, but just who's against? Starting blocks are, and with that we're actually going to go to our debaters. You have their complete bios on the website, so I'll be very brief. I'll just put them in the order in which they're going to argue. So for the motion that commercial arbitration requires more transparency, we'll have Gabriele Ruscello from the ICC. That is of course a good match. Gabriele is a counsel at the ICC and leads the Swiss-Italian team there. And then against the motion that commercial arbitration warrants more transparency is Arif Ali, who's a partner at Deckard and the co-chair of Deckard's international arbitration practice, basing his time in Washington and London. And then we move to investment arbitration, and we have here arguing for the motion Samantha Rowe, who's with Debevoise and Plimpton, who's a New York bar and has degrees in English and French law, so a very international mixture here. She just came recently back from New York to London. And she's arguing for the motion, and then we'll have against the motion in investment arbitration Richard Power, who's a partner with Clyde and Co. So with that, a good debate. It will be 10 minutes each, and I will be strict on time.
Thank you very much, Maxi, and thank you for the organizer for inviting me here. I'm happy to say for once that my opinions actually match with the current trend of the ICC. And it's also Wendy Myers, who is vice president of the court, may confirm it. My job is not going to be incredibly tough because I saw that many people are already in favor of transparency in commercial arbitration. But I will basically touch two main points, an external dimension of transparency and an institutional dimension of transparency. And within the external dimension, I will consider whether or not it's a good choice to apply the use of tribunal rules on transparency to commercial arbitration cases, if there is any difference between investment arbitration and commercial arbitration as far as transparency is concerned, why should awards be available, and whether or not amicus curiae would be a good option for commercial arbitral tribunals. And for the institutional transparency, I will mention two ICC, practices that are leading to a broader transparency of the ICC decisions, both at the court and the secretariat levels. So, should the UNCTAD rules on transparency be applied to commercial arbitration? As we all know, the UNCTAD rules were established to create a more transparent regime for investor-state arbitrations. However, even if people were against the transparency in commercial arbitration, will tell you that there is a problem of confidentiality and of sensitive information in commercial arbitration cases. There is a very nice provision in the UCITRA rules, Article 7, which states that there might be exceptions to this transparency, especially as far as confidential or protected information is concerned. And Article 7.2 states that confidential or protected information consists of confidential business information, information that is protected against being made available to the public under any law or rules determined by the arbitral tribunal to be applicable to the disclosure of such information. Which means that if, I mean, in principle, there could be the application of these new rules on transparency even to commercial arbitration cases, and the parties, of course, can in their negotiations include confidentiality clauses specifying what kind of business information they would like to keep confidential. As far as the differences between investor state and commercial arbitration is concerned, I attended a conference a few days ago in Paris, and it was interesting because there was a very prominent law professor saying that his function changes when he acts as arbitrator in commercial cases and when he acts as arbitrator in investor state cases. He says that basically when he is president of an arbitral tribunal in investor state cases, he feels that he's building a body of law that protects not only commercial and business interests, but it goes behind that and protects also social, environmental interests and human rights. Whereas when he does that, when he sits in commercial arbitral tribunals, that is not the case, and he's just there to settle a dispute between commercial actors. Now, I am bringing some statistics from the ICC. 10% of the cases in 2015 involved a state or a state entity. Now, we're not talking about investor state cases, we're not talking about BITs provided for an ICC clause in the treaty. We are talking about contracts where, but contract leading to a dispute where a state or a state entity is involved. Now, when this is the case and the state is involved, there is of course a public interest. Especially because usually when the state is involved in an ICC arbitration, we are talking about oil and gas disputes, we are talking about telecommunication disputes, we are talking about disputes that of course have also a kind of public interest. And when we see, for instance, the public concern involved in ICC arbitration, we may think, for instance, to the compensation owed by the state. That compensation will be paid with public funds. And ultimately, these public funds are basically the taxpayers' funds. When there is an allegation of state misconduct and corruption, that's a public interest as well, because it doesn't go only against the government, but it goes against the state more in general. And then, of course, there is a use of public authority in this kind of disputes. So we might consider that public interests are at stake in international commercial arbitrations as well. I'm not saying that they are involved in all commercial arbitrations, but in those arbitrations that I just mentioned where state or state entity is directly involved, that public concern is involved as well. So the third point is why the awards should be available. First of all, the question is, should all the awards be available? And the answer is, of course, no. Some of them, they are not interesting, but some of them, they are... we can say that. And some of them, they are not useful for a development of what we call the arbitration law. However, and there as well, I have opinions from very experienced practitioners who say, sometimes we are so happy to find, for instance, an article mentioning many awards from the ICC, mentioning many awards on force majeure clause or hardship clause, because it gives the arbitrators, who are eventually the judges on commercial disputes, gives them the possibility to have a broader interpretation of that clause under a certain specific applicable law. So it's interesting not only for academics, students, and so on, but it might be also interesting for practitioners and ultimately for arbitrators who have to judge these disputes. The amicus curiae is a little bit more difficult, I think, because in commercial cases, it's difficult for a third party to know that there actually is a dispute going on. The dispute originally is not publicly available, so it's difficult for a third party to intervene and to send an amicus curiae. However, there is a provision in the ICC rules that might be interpreted as opening doors to amicus curiae, which is, if I'm not wrong, I'm sorry, it's Article 25.3, that provides or allows the arbitral tribunal to hear not only the parties involved in the arbitration proceedings, but any party that the arbitral tribunal might consider helpful for the settlement of the dispute. So I'm not saying that this has been used by arbitral tribunals to invoke a third-party amicus curiae brief, but it might be an option, of course. We had a few cases at the ICC where either the arbitral tribunals asked for an external opinion to institutions, especially in case of antitrust law, and that institution is the European Commission. Now, these amicus curiae were not mentioned in the final award. These amicus curiae were not used as a basis for the decision of the arbitral tribunal, but of course it was a good interpretative tool for the arbitral tribunal to find decision. As far as the international institutional transparency is concerned, I will just mention you two rules. The first one is 11.4 at the ICC rules. Now, the 11.4 article provided before that no decisions of the court, or actually the reasons of the decisions of the court, were not publicly available, so the parties were not able to ask for decisions. However, in the 2012 rules, when the rules were modified, the Article 11.4 became different. So this, it states that the decisions of the court as to the appointment, confirmation, challenge, or replacement of an arbitrator shall be final. But the wording and the reasons for such decisions shall not be communicated does not exist anymore. How does it work? It worked that, for instance, the parties, when they know that there is a decision taken by the court on these specific issues, may ask the secretariat to provide the reasons of such a decision before that decision actually takes place. And we give the decision, of course, if we are requesting to do so by the parties. The second and last point that I want to deal with is the name of the arbitrators. Now, that was a very controversial measure that was undertaken by the ICC. And I think that day after day, the people are actually accepting that measure, because it's important for the parties who are out there to know how many cases, for instance, a person is dealing with as arbitrator, whether this person is acting as president of an arbitral tribunal on 20 cases or on 40 cases or on 50 cases, because it gives you an impression and a picture of the availability of that person. The second point is also that the arbitral world has been dominated by men and very, I'm saying something very inappropriate, but very old people for for too many decades, I'm speaking about 90 years old. and an institution such as the ICC showing that we're actually nominating appointing or confirming arbitrators who are much younger and also who belong to the female category is very important for the public out there. So these are measures, transparency measures that the institution adopts, and I'm sure that they are good inputs for other institutions and in general for all actors of the arbitration world. Thank you.
Thanks a lot for being here for this very passionate vision and also being in touch.
Right, so Maxi is going to make sure that I do this in 10 minutes. But before I start, I applaud Wendy for again reminding everybody about the importance of diversity and particularly gender diversity. But I will also make a plea for ethnic diversity. And when we have achieved ethnic and gender diversity, we have really made significant progress. We've made a lot of progress in the world of gender diversity or in that area, but not so much in the world of ethnic diversity. And here's why this is important. When you look around the room and you look at all the people from the so-called developing world, less developed countries, third world countries, guess what? I'm not less developed anything. I'm not third world anything. I come from the majority world, because those who come from those parts of the world are in fact the majority. And within the majority world, the majority are women. And so, Wendy, I hope you'll join me in supporting this idea that we need both gender diversity as well as ethnic diversity on panels and as part of the arbitral forum. The second thing that I will do is give you a lesson in advocacy. Not a great lesson, but a small and important one. And that is, the first thing you do when you are in rebuttal is to address the points that have just been made by your opponent. And the point that my opponent has made, while very eloquent, are completely wrong. And they are wrong. And they are wrong, I tell you, because what he says is classically the tail wagging the dog. And the first point that he mentioned to you, 10% of cases involve states. Well, 90% of the cases don't involve states. Should we therefore impose institutional reform? Should we therefore impose legal reform in order to accommodate those 10% of cases that are that involve states? And those 10% of cases that are in the world of commercial arbitration. In commercial arbitration, these are typically disputes involving non-payment for bananas for the military. Yes, they might involve an oil concession. Yes, they might involve a power plant. But they do not involve state responsibility. And that is the big differentiation that militates against transparency when it comes to international commercial arbitration. Now, on that point, I hope, my dear friend, you will concede. Good. I expected that. And on the second point, I will use your own words. Should awards be published? All awards are not available because they are not interesting. Well, for the small minority that are interesting, should the tail be wagging the dog? Do you now concede, my good friend? Do not. Okay. Well, what difference does it make to an arbitrator sitting in a dispute involving Chinese law and application of force majeure to know what the application of the principle of force majeure was under Bangladeshi or French law? What educational purpose is to be served for the arbitrator? Zero. More importantly, what about precedent? There is no precedent in international commercial arbitration, so why do we need the publication of awards? Are you now convinced, my good friend?
Not at all.
Okay, so we have another step to go. Now, transparency is a very, very big word. For some, it's a policy. For others, a principle. For others, a rule, like the ICC. For some, it's an aspiration. And for others, it is a sin. But at the end of the day, why do we talk about transparency? First of all, because anybody, a rule maker, a government, any institution that uses the word transparency, uses it to legitimize what it is doing, without actually talking about what transparency really means. And so I ask you to think about that. The hypocrisy that often underlies the proposition that I am being transparent. But there are two other reasons why transparency becomes an important part of the discussion. And while I saw that 50% of the room were against transparency in commercial arbitration and 50% for, and my good friend refuses to concede, I will say this: transparency, it's very hard to debate against transparency. Why? Because it is in human nature to want to know, to be curious, to draw back the curtain and look behind, to walk into the cave that is dark. It is human nature. Why, after all, are you here? Well, some of you, because you want a job. be transparent. Others, because you want to peel back the curtain and see what is behind in the world of arbitration, right? So, there is, in arguing against transparency, I am arguing against human instinct. But there is also another instinct, and it is this. And I'll read to you from, give you a quote from Douglas Horton from 1891. He's an American preacher. Change occurs in direct proportion to dissatisfaction. But dissatisfaction never changes. And I will add to the eloquence of Mr. Horton by saying, to Preacher Horton, by saying, and lawyers are amongst the most dissatisfied of all. And so our curiosity that we bring to the table, that calls for transparency, married with our general state of being of dissatisfaction, makes it very difficult to argue against transparency, notwithstanding the brilliant points I made earlier and the fact that my good friend will not concede. Nonetheless, I ask you to do the following for me. Each and every one, put away your BlackBerries and your phones, close your laptops, put down your pens, and close your eyes. Everyone. You too, Mark. Close your eyes. All of you, close your eyes. You haven't closed your eyes. And as you think, in the quiet of your mind, I ask you to consider the following proposition that is fundamental in evaluating the question of transparency and commercial arbitration. And it is this: party autonomy. You may now open your eyes. Party autonomy. Party and autonomy. The gateway to the world of international commercial arbitration, the fundamental precept, the fundamental principle that you and I can reach agreement about how we are going to resolve our dispute. The fundamental gateway that we will reflect in our agreement, the exclusion in the first instance of the public fora in which dispute resolution takes place, that is the publicly funded courts. And we will decide on the procedural mechanism pursuant to which our dispute will be resolved. And as you think about party autonomy, I ask you also to consider another proposition. And it is this: we have, through our legalistic and regulatory mindsets, reflecting our dissatisfaction, our constancy of dissatisfaction, made international arbitration an end in and of itself. It is not. It is a means to an end. Consider that, my friends. It is a means to the resolution of a dispute between two or more consenting parties who choose to be in that forum for particular reasons. And they choose to be in that forum because two commercial parties may not want a competitor to know that they're having a dispute. 90% or more of disputes are smaller disputes for which there's no public incentive or purpose to or interest to be forwarded or advanced as a result of greater transparency. So again, we have the tail wagging the dog. And I will put to you the following, that transparency needs to be looked at in four different contexts. First of all, organizational transparency. At the end of the day, unless the organizations, the institutions that are the creators of the rules and the administrators of the rules, if they are not more transparent, they cannot call for greater transparency. So transparency, yes, I will concede to my good friend who represents one of the institutions that has made great steps in advancing transparency, that institutional transparency is important because that does create greater clarity for the users of the system. There is the notion of arbitrator transparency. Arbitrator intelligence and other mechanisms out there to try and get out into the world how it is that arbitrators think, how it is that arbitrators decide, why they decide in a particular way, to use artificial intelligence and apply it to arbitrator decision making. You know what? I disagree. Let the market decide.
I think you disagree in like 10 seconds.
I will. And so, unfortunately, I don't have time to talk about the transparency of proceedings, but in the course of the debate that I think will follow, hopefully we'll make some of my points there, or with respect to legal transparency. But at the end of the day, if you want to destroy international commercial arbitration, yeah, stick with your vote. Stick with your vote for greater transparency. Because by doing so, you will be committing the cardinal sin. And that cardinal sin is you will be destroying party autonomy. And you will be destroying the most fundamental element that underlies our human instinct. And that is freedom of choice. Thank you.
Hypnosis,
partially. Which is unfair.
I'm not going to ask if this being a lesson of advocacy if he actually believes in what he said. But we'll now turn to investor-state arbitration. And we will start with the motion for transparency, and the floor is now with you, Samantha.
Thank you, and thank you so much for having me here today, and congratulations on organising what has been a really fantastic conference. Increasing transparency in investment treaty arbitration, is it welcome? Well, you've all voted with your hands already. Yes, it is welcome, and it's not only welcome, it is necessary, and this is why. This is just a small handful of media reports that have come out in the last few years criticizing ISDS, investor state dispute system. And the key word that screams out from all of these reports is secret. Rightly or wrongly, there is a real concern that ISDS is an illegitimate system of resolving disputes, because decisions that affect millions of people and the public purse are being made behind closed doors. And if we want to combat this concern, the only way to do so is by increasing transparency. And not only increasing transparency, by increasing transparency transparently. So transparency squared, if you will, and I'll come back to what that means. But more than that, ISDS is a system of laws. It is a system that applies laws, and it is a system that creates law. And as such, if it is going to be legitimate, it needs to respect the rule of law. And legal transparency, as we all know from our constitutional law classes, is an absolutely fundamental tenet of what the rule of law means. So before moving on to this in a little bit more substance, I've done a sort of brief survey of the transparency measures that are out there at the moment, and you'll see down the side that there's sort of two categories. There's the disclosure, the outward flow of information to adopt Maxi's terminology, and participation, the inward flow. And there are the sort of the formal rules, the formal positions under the rules, and there's also the discretionary party agreement positions that can be adopted in favour of transparency as well. And what I think this slide shows us is that transparency is real and it's here to stay. And we've come a long way from the first ICSID dispute, Holiday Inns in Morocco, in which the decisions that were rendered remain unpublished, to this day. So transparency is here. Is it welcome? Is it necessary? And the answer is yes, and I'm just going to walk you through five reasons why that is the case. And the first is, well, it's a fundamental tenet of the rule of law, I've already touched on this. We've come a long way from Holiday Inns in Morocco, not only in terms of the transparency measures that are now part of the system, but also in terms of the substance of the disputes that are being decided within the investor state dispute resolution system. In the last few years, we've seen cases concerning the emergency measures that Argentina adopted to combat the financial meltdown in the early noughties. We've seen cases concerning public health measures adopted in relation to cigarette packaging. We've seen cases concerning environmental damage to the Amazon rainforest. And we also have the current NAFTA challenge, which is suspended now, over the Keystone Pipeline in the United States of America. And even putting that substance to one side, every award that is rendered by an ISDS tribunal has the potential to affect the public purse. The UCOS award was worth $50 billion before it was set aside, and that is money that is coming from the taxpayers' pocket. So we have issues of real public concern, and we have literally billions of dollars at stake. We are all affected by this system. We are all stakeholders in this system, not least because we're all citizens of the states that signed up to it. So that gives us all the right to know what's going on, and not only that, to be able to affect what's going on by participating in the system. Second, ISDS is a system that creates law. And I just want to quote Jan Paulsen here, who said, "It is pointless to resist the observation that precedents generate norms of international law. It is a fact of life before international courts and tribunals." And as all of you know, and as I know as an associate in international disputes practice, the first thing we do when we are faced with a new dispute or when we're faced with the interpretation of a norm under the system is to go and look at how other people have treated it, how other people have decided it. And let's not forget that the dispute resolution provisions of bilateral investment treaties are just one part of a much broader system. ISDS, in its full realised glory, creates a supranational body of norms to regulate sovereign conduct. It is forward-looking, it is not just ex post facto dispute resolution. And it can only do that, it can only fulfil that promise if the decisions that are being made that interpret those norms are made public. And actually, we've gone much beyond that recently with state counterclaims and with defences involving public policy norms such as corruption. We're not just talking about norms for state conduct, we're talking about norms for investor conduct too. Third, a fully transparent ISDS system creates certainty, predictability, and equality before the law. We need to see these decisions, to know what they say, and to be able to adapt our behaviour accordingly, and this relates back to the previous point. But by having a fully transparent system, we also create pressure moving forward for tribunals to follow previous decisions unless there is good reason to do otherwise. That is how a system of precedent works, and it ensures that the decisions will be consistent, that the parties that are subject to this dispute resolution process are treated equally, like treated as like, and that when you are before one of these tribunals, you have some sense of which way the decision is going to go. That allows us all to create that cost-benefit analysis of whether to even bring one of these cases in the first place. Number four, we get better decisions. In two ways, and this goes back to the outward flow of information and the inward flow of information. The inward flow of information, increased participation, allows bodies and individuals with relevant expertise to provide information and perspective that is relevant to the decisions that these tribunals are making. And a great example of this is the Philip Morris case, where the World Health Organization was allowed to participate as amicus. And the tribunal in that case recognised not only that the WHO would be able to assist them in reaching a better decision, but also that the decision that they ultimately reached would be more legitimate in the eyes of the public because they had taken these perspectives into account. And then there's also the outward flow of information. Tribunals who know that the world is watching are under more pressure to get their decision right, to get it right, to make sure that it's well-reasoned. And actually, Stephen Schull had something very relevant to say on this. When arbitrators know that the world will read and critically assess their words, they are likely to put more thought and time into how they reason their decisions. They are also more likely to subject the content of their awards to the test of whether the reasons can stand up to sophisticated debate. Finally, and I'm going to end where I started. We've heard today from Monsieur Durand, through all of the other panels, that we're currently facing a huge backlash against ISDS. It is no overstatement to say that the system is under threat, and a huge part of that is a concern that there is insufficient transparency. Now, I will say here that I agree that a lot of this is based on misinformation. As I was preparing for today, I actually read a Guardian article that cited the ExxonMobil Canada NAFTA case as an example of one of these secret tribunal decisions. Now, I was an associate working on that case at Debevoise, and I must have spent about 100 hours redacting submissions, transcripts, decisions, procedural orders, because literally everything was published on the Canadian government's website. There's a huge amount of transparency concerning that proceeding, and I'm sure you're all now really excited about your future practice and the international dispute resolution firm. It's there's misinformation out there, and frankly the media has been quite irresponsible in the way that this has all been reported. There isn't the answer to that, and actually it's the only answer that I can think of, to be more transparent, and not only to be more transparent, but to educate the public about what we have done to address their concerns. And that requires much more than just publishing decisions on the ICSID website or on any other website that us eggheads visit on a regular basis, but that nobody else has any idea exists. And so that's what I mean when I say we have to transparently increase transparency, because that is the only way that we are going to rescue the system from itself. And I think I did that within 10 minutes. You did?
Increase transparency in a transparent way. Now, last but certainly not least, Richard, and who is then against the motion of transparency in investor-state arbitration, and you have an uphill battle, I'm afraid.
Thank you, Maxie. good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I've been asked to oppose the motion that increasing transparency in investment arbitration is a welcome reform. This seems at first glance to be a difficult task, and it seems a lot more difficult after I've seen the hands against me. Indeed, numerous articles and journals which I've read refer to it as self-evident that investment arbitration requires increased transparency. However, my education at this very university taught me to question points which people say are self-evident. In fact, while some of the recent reforms to increase transparency in investment arbitration are to be welcomed, some go too far. Certainly, I would suggest that there is no justification for any more transparency. That would deprive the process of its unique character and operate as a barrier to investment. Arbitration, by its nature, is not transparent. While international arbitration differs from seat to seat and from rules to rules, some defining constants can be identified. Firstly, arbitration is a private process between the parties to the arbitration agreement or the treaty. Third parties generally cannot participate in the arbitration. Flowing from that is confidentiality, which is recognised to a greater or lesser extent in most systems and rules. If the process is private, the parties should be able to keep proceedings and awards confidential. Finally, party autonomy allows the parties to choose a flexible procedure suited to their needs, which can and should be speedier and less costly than national courts. I say can and should, not is. Therefore, if transparency as a concept permits public attendance at hearings, the publicity of awards and submissions, and third parties to join in and or contribute to the proceedings, then transparency makes inroads into the essential nature of international arbitration. It's logical that such inroads should only go so far as is reasonably necessary to achieve legitimate goals. To go any further would be to change the essential nature of international arbitration. This is not an academic concern. Parties choose to use international arbitration because of its nature. In particular, users see confidentiality as a highly important characteristic. Moreover, the involvement of third parties in an arbitration would inevitably cause delay and increase costs. Ladies and gentlemen, the system that we already have already offers sufficient transparency. As you've seen from Samantha's presentation, the key rules for investment arbitration, like the ICSID rules and the revised UNCITRAL rules, provide that information about the proceedings, including awards, is publicly available. Interested third parties may become involved in the arbitration, usually via amicus curiae briefs. And some rules, such as the anti-trial transparency rules, even provide for submissions and evidence to be publicly available and for hearings to take place in public. In addition, most rules and the IBA guidelines on conflicts of interest in international arbitration require arbitrators to be impartial and unbiased, require disclosure of potential conflicts of interest, and allow parties to challenge the appointment of arbitrators. For those reasons, ladies and gentlemen, I would suggest that any moves to increase transparency in investment arbitration would not be welcome. But have we gone too far already? Has the recent trend for increased transparency in investment arbitration, culminating in those revised anti-trial rules and the Mauritius Convention, been a welcome innovation? Let's consider the justifications for transparency with the critical eye of a user of investment arbitration and see whether those justifications stack up, and if they do, whether the measures already adopted go only so far as is reasonably necessary to achieve those legitimate goals. The first proposal is that transparency is an essential part of the rule of law. That sounds like a trite point. Justice must be done and seen to be done. However, it's a sweeping statement which, from a practical point of view, means nothing in itself. Transparency of judicial proceedings became an accepted part of the rule of law to ensure that judges, who were originally the monarch's representatives and an emanation of state power, did not abuse that power, which could involve the loss of life, liberty, and property. In contrast, arbitration is a private dispute resolution mechanism. The parties have chosen it precisely to extricate the dispute from national courts and the very judges whose power that principle was designed to curtail. I don't think it can be seriously argued that international commercial arbitration is an affront to the rule of law simply because it lacks any meaningful degree of transparency. I'd suggest the same is true of investor-state arbitrations. As I mentioned earlier, the IBA guidelines and most institutional rules provide sufficient protection for the parties from biased arbitrators. Second proposition, transparency is necessary to encourage public confidence in the system. As Samantha has said, this is currently the rallying call of those proposing more transparency in investment arbitrations. Articles in the legal and the general media complain of secret tribunals composed of a small band of elite specialists conspiring with the forces of global capitalism to undermine democracy by imposing awards on states via TPP, TTIP, NAFTA. Does that sound familiar, ladies and gentlemen? Well, to me, it sounds disturbingly close to the Daily Mail's rant-a-thon about an elitist band of unelected judges trying to thwart the public's will on Brexit. Is there really a lack of public confidence in investment arbitration? I've yet to meet one businessman or woman, let alone a member of the public at large, who's expressed any concern about the openness in investment arbitration. For me, I think public concern is probably that being expressed by NGOs, by pressure groups, and probably by academics. I'll turn to whether those concerns are legitimate just now. But even if we accept that those concerns are legitimate, public confidence in investment arbitration can, and I agree with Samantha here, be achieved by educating the public on how the system works and how it guarantees fairness. It does not require new rules which can bring with them detrimental side effects. Propositions 3 and 4 can be taken together because they're essentially two sides of the same coin. The first is that investment arbitration concerns proceedings directed against state actions undertaken for the public good, and the second is that the consequence of the arbitration can be damages payable by the state, which impacts on state budget, which impacts on the public. Now, undoubtedly, those concerns justify a degree of increased transparency. But those points don't imply that the tribunal in an investment arbitration should be treated like a democratically elected government. Tribunals don't exist by the will of the people. They exist by the will of the parties to the arbitration agreement or the treaty. They don't make law. They don't make policy decisions. At a theoretical level, I'd submit that there's no justification for demanding public scrutiny of their dealings. And moreover, just because a state is involved in a commercial matter doesn't mean that there has to be full public scrutiny. Members of the public and NGOs don't get to sit in on negotiations between a state and a foreign investor about, for example, the construction of a gas pipeline. They don't get to make suggestions as to how protections of the national interest or human rights could be included in the contract which is ultimately agreed. Similarly, there's little openness about the minutiae of negotiating a bi or multilateral treaty. Why then should there be public access to legal proceedings about those agreements or treaties? It may be that the public has an interest in knowing about a state's decision to nationalise an investment or the like, but that can and should be addressed at a domestic political level or in the national courts at the time the decision is made. The public's interest in the dispute which arises as a result of that decision surely extends only to publication of the award, and that way they know what has been decided and usually why. It seems to me that the public is in an analogous position to the shareholders of a company whose investment has been expropriated by a state. Those shareholders have lost out on money, but they don't have a right to join in the arbitration, to make submissions and have their say. Why should the members of the public of the respondent state have that right? There's no real practical justification for allowing public access to proceedings, amicus curiae briefs, or joined up. The state can and must be trusted to put forward its best arguments and proceedings the same way as any other party. If they fail to do so, then the NGOs and members of the public can take action against the state domestically. Proposition 5, transparency assists the development of international law. That's a laudable principle. But really, should the participants of investment arbitration, and in particular, the investor who has had its assets taken away by state action, have to bear the additional cost, time, and loss of confidentiality which transparency causes in order to achieve what is fundamentally an academic concern? Even if this is a legitimate justification for transparency anyway, surely it can be achieved simply by publishing the awards. Proposition 6, transparency ensures the quality of arbitral decisions, as we've heard. Maybe, perhaps it does. I would suggest, though, that a better guarantee of the quality of awards are the existing provisions for institutional scrutiny and for challenging awards. For example, ICSID has an inbuilt annulment procedure. The New York Convention enables enforcement of an award to be challenged on various grounds, and ICC-administered awards are scrutinised by the ICC court. In any event, does this justify the degree of transparency that we have now? Again, I would suggest, this concern can be met simply by publishing the awards. And finally, human rights issues are involved, or might be involved. This is what we've heard. A state might say that its action, which is the subject matter of the arbitration, is justified to protect human rights. But just because human rights is involved, it doesn't justify third-party involvement in the arbitration. The question the arbitral tribunal is being asked is not whether the state is right or wrong to try and achieve that stated goal, or even whether it has the power or the ability to do so. The tribunal is merely being asked to determine whether an investor has been afforded protection against the consequences of that action, and therefore whether it's entitled to compensation. Again, the interests of the public, NGOs and pressure groups as regards human rights in this context is satisfied by their rights to lobby, campaign and vote. The state can perfectly well justify its actions to the tribunal by reference to human rights without the need for third-party intervention. And finally, even if this is a legitimate concern permitting third-party involvement, it doesn't justify blanket rules which erode privacy and confidentiality. Third-party participation should be limited to situations where the tribunal finds that human rights issues are engaged by the dispute before it, and that they require the assistance of a third party in order to understand the issue and to determine it. In conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, while the special nature of investor-state arbitrations requires some increased transparency over and above that existing in commercial arbitrations, further transparency measures than what we already have would simply go too far. Moreover, some of the recent changes to the rules governing investment arbitrations are not welcome, because they amount to an unjustified infringement on some of the key aspects of any international arbitration, and add time, cost, and complication to what is already a complex process.